Hello friends, welcome to daily editorial enrichment program presented to you by LAIC's R&D team. Today we will look at some of the important articles in the Hindu newspaper for October 23rd, 2019. We have selected some of the important articles from today's Hindu newspaper. The article name along with the issue and page number has been given here. The first article that we will be discussing today is recording crimes. This particular article holds significance for GS2 paper, particularly in the subtopic governance. This is important both from mains and prelims perspective. This has been written in the context of the report released by National Crime Records Bureau recently. Before we delve into the deeper aspect of this particular article, let us first basically understand what NCRB is. It is nothing but an Indian government agency responsible for collecting and analyzing crime data as defined by the Indian Penal Code and special local laws. NCRB is headquartered in New Delhi and is part of the Ministry of Home Affairs. This kind of data might be important from prelims perspective, so we suggest that the aspirants take care about this. Let us now understand some of the important features of this particular Crime in India report. This report, which was published recently, contains data on hate crimes, mob lynching, car panchayat and murders. These new indicators have been added recently in the report published. As we know, these particular incidents have been increasing in India in recent times. Having data on hate crimes will help states in forming a separate law that could deal with the situation comprehensively or come up with other suitable measures to combat this challenge. From the perspective of policy making, this is quite important. Even recently, the Supreme Court of India suggested that there be a separate law for lynching. Having data in this regard might be very helpful for us. In spite of the new indicators, there are many concerns with the report that have been highlighted. For example, some categories of crimes have not been included, such as crimes by Northeast insurgents, left-wing extremists and terrorists. Another concern that has been highlighted with respect to this particular report is that the NCRB data hides significant variances in case registration of serious crimes such as rapes and violence against women across state. This will make a state-wise comparison of crimes committed against women really difficult. The other drawback in the report is the use of census-based year as 2001 to calculate crime rates for state and 2011 for metropolitan cities. These kind of two estimates for states and major metropolitan cities will make the assessment not really helpful for the policy makers in a comprehensive manner. A major concern with the report was the delay in which it was published. The central government blamed the state government for this particular delay. They accused the state government for not providing the data, the required data, in a timely manner. Whenever a policymaker tries to make a policy, the first thing that comes to their mind is the data that is available. If there is no data, it is very difficult for a policymaker to come up with a proper solution. In this particular article, the author says that there was a delay of 2 years in publishing this data. Such kind of delay will have a negative effect on improving the justice in the society. So, the takeaway point from this particular article is access to reliable and timely data will help in coming up with governance solutions which will help in combating the rise of rate of crimes in our country. The next article that we are going to discuss today is Firm Steps to Ease the Fiscal Federalism Tension. This particular article has been written from the perspective of GS2 paper. This article is important for mains answer writing. This has been written in the context of a new proposal made by the central government. Before we analyze this particular article in its bare detail, let us understand some of the data that they have mentioned in the article. For example, most of the taxes collected in India, over 80%, comes from income tax and sales tax. Income tax is a direct tax levied and collected by the center, while sales tax is an indirect tax. The power of state to levy indirect tax was diluted due to the implementation of goods and services tax, GST. This makes states dependent on center for fiscal allocation. The central government is harping about cooperative federalism and trying to dilute or trying to encroach upon the state's power to levy taxes. That is one of the aspects that the author highlights in this particular article, and he gives the example of GST. Such dilution of powers for a democratically elected state government is against the federal nature of our constitution itself. The central government is using the excuse of cooperative federalism to get its new proposal passed. What is this proposal? The proposal is to set up a permanent expenditure fund created for defense by dipping into the state share of 48% from the fiscal pool, which will further make the states poorer. This kind of scenarios might prove to be destructive to stable relations between central and state governments. What could be then truly be done to improve cooperative federalism in India? State government should be given power to levy income tax. In countries such as US, such provision exists. We can bring an amendment to make sure that even state governments in India have the power to levy income taxes. This extra resource will help state to augment their resource capability and make sure that their programs are implemented in the truest and effective manner. It will also give the state government enough independence to design programs which will reflect on their state's growth without depending upon the central government for any financial allocation. The author in this particular article has quoted the example of midday meals scheme in Tamil Nadu to make the point. More fiscal independence to the state governments will give them the necessary motivation to come up with programs such as midday meal scheme, which will have an impact in improving both the standard and the quality of life in their states. The next article that we'll be discussing today is Leaving the Door Open to a Border Settlement. This article is important for GS2 paper, particularly from the mains perspective. This has been written in the context of border disputes between India and China. Border issues between India and China has been a thorn in ensuring positive engagements between the country since the independence of both the countries. We have fought 1962 war with China. In the recent few years, we also had a skirmish along the border which came to be known as Doklam crisis. The relationship between India and China was very weak at that particular point of time. If we do not take suitable measures in this regard, the border issues might become a much larger irritant between the positive relationship between both the countries. Let us try to understand the historical perspective of the border issues. The role of British in this particular perspective is quite important. The British did not have any integrated policy in delineating boundaries which were acceptable to all the parties that they were involved. These policies are the root cause of many disputes between India and China. Example, China-India debate in the northern border. I mentioned Doklam crisis in the earlier part of this particular video. British policies were further complicated in the western sector. This inefficient policy led to both the India and China claiming certain areas in the sector. Example is Aksai Chin. As we can see from the examples that we have just quoted before, the role of British in this particular border dispute is quite huge. They delineated boundaries in a very arbitrary and illogical manner. Since independence, both the countries have taken various measures to solve this border dispute. However, in 2005, there was a positive development. Both India and China had agreed upon political parameters and guiding principle for the settlement of India-China boundary question. What is this 2005 agreement? It is an agreement that identifies the principles on which border defense cooperation would be carried out. If you want to know more about this particular argument, just go to the Ministry of External Affairs website and you will find an exhaustive write-up on this particular agreement. For the purpose of this particular video, let us understand some of the basic principles. First, it placed emphasis on information sharing, military exercises, aircraft, demolition operations, and unmarked mines, and take consequent measures conducive to maintenance of peace and stability Another important feature of this particular agreement was the flag meeting or border personnel at designated places along the line of actual control in the India-China border areas. This particular agreement shows the conviction of both the countries to deal with the border issues in a peaceful manner. The author in this particular article also mentions about something called as missed opportunity. In the late part of the 20th century, the Chinese leader had proposed the idea of recognizing Arunachal Pradesh as part of India, provided India recognized Aksaichin as part of China. This idea, if accepted, would have resolved all outstanding border issues between India and China. However, it was rejected by Indian political leaders because of fear of domestic compulsions. The inability of the Indian side to countenance the swap principle was a missed opportunity that could have eventually settled the dispute and contained the escalating conflict in the ensuing years. We could have not had the war itself, and the Doklam crisis would never have happened. The takeaway point from this particular article is, border issue is a major irritant. We have to solve this issue at the earliest, and we should be open to any opportunities that might come. These opportunities could also be in the form of the swap principle that we just explained. The next article that we are going to discuss today is looking at the larger picture. This particular article is important from the perspective of GS2 paper. This article can be useful in our preparation for UPSC mains answer writing. This has been written in the context of Turkey's stand on Kashmir and its effect on foreign policy on India. Recently, the Prime Minister of India, PM Modi, cancelled his visit to Turkey. This was because of the rising tension between the two countries. What is the cause of this rising tension? The tension started to rise after President Recep Tayyip Erdogan's United Nations General Assembly speech in September, in which he criticized the Indian government's move to remove the special status accorded to Jammu and Kashmir by the dilution of Article 370. Let us analyze the impact of this particular recent decision taken by the central government. Some have criticized it to be a knee-jerk reaction on part of India, since historically speaking, Turkey has always sided with Pakistan on the issue of Kashmir. Both these countries are also members of organizations such as Organization of Islamic Countries. The government should not have let this decision of Turkey impact the overall relationship it had developed with Turkey in recent time. Example, the economic partnership between the countries had increased in recent times. One other thing that we have to remember is Turkey is one of the important countries in that particular region. It has considerable human resources, considerable trade opportunities, and more importantly, it also has the technological capacity to attain nuclear weapon capability that will add to their influence in the region. It was unwise of India to alienate Turkey over isolated incidents. The takeaway point from this particular article is, isolated incident should not be allowed to affect India's overall relationship with Turkey, which is a pivotal power in the region. We also have to remember that India has several issues with China. Even China has taken its stand, which is against India, on the issue of Article 370. But however, we are trying to improve our relations with China. In spite of their stand against us, we just had a successful informal summit. Government should have taken such a stand towards Turkey also. The next piece of news that we are going to look today is, quote, to look into government plea for access to WhatsApp chats. Those of us who use WhatsApp know that the messages that we send are encrypted. WhatsApp claims that these messages cannot be read even by themselves. But several governments across the world have objected to this particular technology used by WhatsApp to protect their customers' messages. They contend that this particular privacy option might be used by certain illegal elements to carry out any illegal activities that are against the interest of the general public. The Information Technology Intermediary Guideline rules place responsibility on the governments to ensure that illegal activities of pornography, sedition, hate, fake news, and other anti-national activities and terror are effectively combated. The privacy feature that is given to customers by WhatsApp and other social media agents make lives of the government much more hard and complicated to combat the challenges that we mentioned earlier. This is one of the basic reasons why the Supreme Court has decided to examine this issue in a greater detail. From the perspective of prelims and both mains, let us understand what are the key features of the rules. The Intermediary Guideline Rules 2011 required intermediaries to prohibit users from hosting certain content on its platform, example, obscene content. We have to understand who these intermediaries are. It can be social media giants. The draft rules also prohibit a new category of information, that is, content which threatens public health or safety. You have to remember that a couple of years ago, there was a WhatsApp forward that said that northeastern people in Karnataka, particularly in Bangalore, were being targeted. This was false and malicious, but because of the spread of WhatsApp, it created fear among the northeastern brothers and sisters, and this led to a huge exodus of northeastern people from Bangalore. This particular draft rule helps the government to fight such malicious and fake news in the society. The intermediaries should also make sure that within 72 hours they provide assistance to any government agency. Further, they should also ensure that they enable tracing of the originator of the information on their platform. The intermediaries also must deploy technologically based automated tools to identify and remove public access to unlawful information. Further, intermediaries with more than 50 lakh users must incorporate a company in India. All these draft rules are aimed to make sure that the challenges of combating pornography, hate, fake news are combated in a successful manner. Making them establish a company in India will also give legal rights to the government to hold them to accountable if anything goes wrong. From the perspective of mains, let us understand what are some of the key issues with respect to this particular guidelines. The first issue is intermediaries are required to prohibit publication of content that threatens public health or safety. This might violate the right of free speech under Article 19, which has already been challenged due to laws such as sedition in our country. Apart from that, intermediaries are required to deploy automated tools for removing access to unlawful content. This may be contrary to the reasoning of a recent Supreme Court judgment. Intermediaries with more than 50 lakh users must incorporate a company in India. It is unclear as to how this number will be calculated. Therefore, an intermediary will find it difficult to determine it is required to set up a company in India under this provision. Another important thing that we need to analyze from this particular news is right to privacy. Right to privacy, particularly in the context of 21st century, is quite important. Keeping this in mind, the Supreme Court delivered a unanimous verdict which overruled the earlier 8-judge bench judgment in MP Sharma case and 6-judge bench judgment in Karak Singh case, both of which had ruled that privacy is not a fundamental right. Supreme Court of India in Puttaswamy case has held that right to privacy is a fundamental right and it is protected under the Article 21 of the Constitution of India. In this particular regard, it is quite interesting to know what the course the Supreme Court will take since it has accepted the plea. The future course of decision that the Supreme Court might take in this particular case will have an impact on the right to privacy and its observance in our country. The next news that we are going to see today is villages demand a new lease of life for Ramgarh Dam. This is important from the perspective of GS3 paper, particularly under the subtopic environment. An agitation has been launched for the protection of catchment area of the historic Ramgarh Dam, which was once considered the lifeline of Jaipur. The villagers and farmers of this particular region are staging a sit-in near the town demanding immediate removal of encroachments. Let's see some more information on the Ramgarh Dam. Its construction was completed in 1904 during the reign of erstwhile Jaipur ruler Sawai Madhav Singh II. The dam, which earlier supplied drinking water to the city, has dried completely in the last decade. The Ramgarh Lake had hosted rowing events during the 1982 Asian Games. Numerous encroachments which came up in the catchment area have altered free flow of water to the dam. What needs to be done in this particular case then? It is very, very simple. Remove encroachments. Supply Chambal River water through the proposed canal system so that the lake is rejuvenated. This particular rejuvenated lake will have a positive impact on the life of the villagers and the farmers in that particular region. It will also improve the aesthetic beauty of that particular region, which can attract tourism, which can also attract many flora and fauna, which will add rich to the agriculture or the environmental biodiversity in the region. From the perspective of prelims, we have mentioned some basic informations with respect to the Chambal River. It originates in Janav Pav near Mau in Madhya Pradesh in the Vindhya mountain range. Its length is 965 kilometers, 370 kilometers is in Rajasthan itself. The water discharges through Yamuna, Panchnanda in Uttar Pradesh. States and major cities through which this Chambal River passes is Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh. The right bank tributaries of Chambal River are Prabhati, Kali Sindh, Shipra. The left bank tributaries are Banas and Mej. The major dams that have been constructed on Chambal River are Gandhi Sagar Dam, Rana Pratap Sagar, Jawahar Sagar and Kota Barrage. The last news that we are going to discuss today is Turkey-Russia strike a deal on Syria. This is important from the perspective of GS2, particularly under international news subtopic. What is this deal about? Both Turkey and Russia agreed on Tuesday to remove the Syrian Kurdish YPG militia to beyond 30 kilometers from the Turkish border, after which their troops will jointly patrol a narrow strip of land in a safe zone. Turkey has sought a safe zone like this for a very long period of time. What is this safe zone? The northern Syria buffer zone, also referred to as the safe zone or peace corridor, was a demilitarized zone established on the Syrian side of the Syrian-Turkish border between August and October 2019 with the purpose of maintaining security along the border and dissuading the prospective Turkish invasion of the self-proclaimed autonomous administration of North and East Syria during the Syrian civil war. One of the few things that we have to remember by reading this particular piece of news is we have to know why Turkey is doing what it is doing, what is the role of Kurds in the region, what is the global dynamic which involves USA, Russia in this particular event. There have been many editorials that have been written in the recent times with respect to the Turkish aggressive move towards the Kurds in the Syrian region. There have been various reasons why Turkey has taken such an action. We have to analyze what the role of the US is, what Russia aims to do. All these aspects have been discussed quite comprehensively in our earlier part of the deep videos. We kindly suggest that you go watch the video again or read some of the editorials that have come in the Hindu newspaper, or else you can also log into IDSA website and read over this particular issue, because this is very important. This is very important to the peace and stability in the region, and it might have a very wide ramification for the whole global order. That is all for today. Thank you.